Hi everyone, Richard Jones, Editorial Director at DevEx, and I'm here with Dr. Phil Febbo, Chief Medical Officer at Illumina. Welcome, Phil.
Thank you.
Well, we're here today at UNGA 77 here in New York City. Perhaps you could just tell me a little bit about your day so far. You've been on stage with our President and Editor-in-Chief, Raj Kumar, earlier. Could you give us a brief synopsis of that conversation?
Well, it's incredible to feel the energy that's back. You know, we've gone through a tough couple of years with COVID, a lot of virtual presentations, and it's great to have the energy of being in the room. And, you know, at Illumina, we're a technology company that makes sequencers, and more those sequencers are used in healthcare, so we're becoming a healthcare company as well. And it's, you know, so important to understand as our technology moves out of the lab and into the clinic, how do we understand the dynamics across the world and the globe, high, middle, and lower income countries, and how our technology can help each of those groups of countries with their health and their healthcare?
And could you maybe walk us through your own role as Chief Medical Officer? What does your day-to-day look like?
Yeah, so as Chief Medical Officer at Illumina, I get the privilege of finding the path to ensure that our technology comes into healthcare and improves patient outcomes as quickly as possible, regardless of that patient's in New York City, where we are today, or in the Democratic Republic of Congo. And so we look at what are the early collaborations and research studies we have to do to show the value of sequencing to human health, what are the products we have to build to enable clinicians and laboratory scientists to bring those tests to the clinic, and then we generate the evidence to show when you test someone with a sequencing-based test that their outcomes improve.
And how has that value proposition been elevated into the public eye through pandemics such as the most recent one, COVID-19? We have monkeypox now, we've had previous Ebola crises. How does this sort of figure and capture the imagination, not only of the global health sector, but the broader public?
Yes, certainly the pandemic, and specifically the emergence of these variants, Alpha, Beta, Delta, Omicron, has jumpstart awareness about the value of understanding not only if a virus is present or absent, detected, not detected, but what about the specifics of that virus? And when you talk about the different variants, you're talking about the sequence. You know, the SARS-CoV-2 has 30,000 bases, and you have to sequence those 30,000 to understand is which variant. And that's created an awareness and a language around how that technology improves public health efforts and individual outcomes. So during the pandemic, it's been quite clear. Our sequencing was used in December 2019 to identify this virus as a novel SARS-CoV-2 virus. That sequence was then made public in January of 2020 and was immediately put to use to create diagnostics, to repurpose medicines to treat, and importantly, to create vaccines. In fact, Moderna never needed to have the virus actually in their labs. All they did is they grabbed that sequence, grabbed the spike protein, and they were off to the races generating what was probably one of the biggest scientific breakthroughs of mankind over the past century.
And I think you're right. I think we've often focused, and certainly the mainstream news coverage has focused on vaccine development and delivery. But of course, there's a whole story that goes on before those shots get into arms around the world, and that's with its own problems. Could you walk us through a little bit about the sort of scale and ways in which genomic sequencing may change the trajectory of global health efforts?
Yeah, so even within this pandemic, initially it was all about using the sequence of the virus to identify those paths to treatment and to effective vaccines. And then once we develop those vaccines, then what we also know is the virus will change. And anytime you put pressure through vaccines or otherwise, that pushes it to even more changes. And so as these variants came up, it became very important to be able to track that. And we saw very quickly the global kind of stakeholders come together and start performing genomic epidemiology, where you're sequencing the virus on a routine basis and being able to watch out for the emergence of specific variants and the disproportionate infection of those variants so that you can change public health measures. we've seen very effectively countries like Australia use genomic sequencing of the virus to understand how the virus gets introduced into their communities to take the measures to stop that. We've seen that reflected in what some colleges and universities have done, what other countries have done. So that's where we see sequencing really help. It creates this code with which you can track pathogens. And right now, we're seeing all that effort on appropriately COVID. But the same is true for major killers across the globe, HIV, tuberculosis, malaria, and those are just the communicable diseases. Also, non-communicable diseases like cancer, sequencing is the path to improved outcomes.
So I was going to talk about, you know, the potential for your work in preventing future pandemics and other health issues. What are some of the barriers here? Is it financing? Is it political will? Is it awareness? Could you walk us through some of the obstacles that you're facing day to day and how we as a global health and global development community might overcome them in practice?
Yeah, I would say there's two ways I'd frame that. First is, what are the obstacles we saw during the pandemic to rapidly respond and help get in front of the pandemic? And those barriers were very much like, okay, we had the technology, but how do you introduce that technology? How do you help educate the scientists locally? How do you support that logistics and just getting, you know, cold chain to get the sequencing into a country, into a laboratory? We found ways to overcome that. And it resulted in many countries now having laboratories with access to our technology to map these variants. The next part is sustainability. And that's what I get more worried about, right? Because then, now you have the technology, but how do you prevent it from becoming a very expensive doorstop or paperweight? You know, how do you make sure there's sustainable funding and we maintain the vigilance? Because what, you know, SARS-CoV-2 was an incredible pandemic that, you know, devastated our economies for a time, shut down the globe. Those kind of pathogens emerge the more you disrupt human and the environment interactions. And with climate change, we're going to see more of those disruptions. So we have to stay vigilant. But that does take sustained support for those laboratories. It takes sustained education of the people in country and sustained will to continue to share and work together. Because so many times these efforts drift apart and become isolated. Right. And what we know from the pandemic is we're not safe until we're all safe. So we have to also have the will to continue to collaborate.
So it's sustainability, it's consistency. Is it all about also about replicability and about scale too?
Yeah, so in order to really understand a pathogen and the changes in its genetics, you have to have standards as far as high quality sequencing, and you have to have the ability to dial that up. And that's where we've really seen in the United States, we have a public health system that has some sequencing capability, but during a pandemic, they're overwhelmed. And so we had some really effective public-private partnerships where the public health was still in charge, but they said, hey, here's a commercial lab. Can you do 10,000? We can do 1,000. Can you do 10,000? That's where the commercial entities can dial that up and scale it much more effectively. And as we move forward, we have to maintain those kind of interactions where public health is always in charge of the health of the communities. They are the gatekeepers. But when an alarm bell rings, they have to, with facility, learn to work better with commercial entities in order to scale rapidly. And that took a little bit of time in the pandemic.
And so what's the evolution of that process? What's the next frontier for Illumina?
Well, I think the next frontier for Illumina with respect to that is, you know, we have built our business over the past 20 years in really making sure we support the large, scalable laboratories. That has been the brunt of our more and more our sequencing's moving, you know, up the chain or out into the field. And those laboratories need more sample to answer solutions like IVDs. They need more support on the software side, so they don't need a team of, you know, expert bioinformaticians. Right. And they need the price to be something that's affordable. And that's where we're working, is to, we'll still continue to support those massive scaled laboratories, but more and more we want to complement that with the field base that'll be the early detectors of what may happen next.
So it's about access, but it's also about equity too.
Absolutely. And, you know, we have a ways to go because a lot of our knowledge and certainly human genetics is driven by all the whole genome sequencing that's been done, quite frankly, in mostly Northern European individuals. Now there's a lot of, with the growing awareness of sequencing and the different ways we can use sequencing to, for example, understand who gets sick with COVID, there's a will and an intention to build that knowledge and include all communities in that data so that everyone can benefit.
And maybe you have a call to action, Phil, to the global health community or the global development community at large. Any next steps on partnership? Any calls to action on the work that they're doing and the attention that they're paying to things like genomic sequencing as a routine part of service delivery?
Well, it's been gratifying and, you know, quite frankly, thrilling to see how during this pandemic, so many stakeholders have come together with a collective will to, you know, bring technology into these laboratories across the globe, support them, resource them, because we had the pandemic. My call to action is, like, obviously the amount of resources will be moderated a little bit, but there's such an opportunity to leverage the incredible jumpstart we've had, continue to work together, don't fall apart into silos, and really work toward a place where we could have proactive pathogen detection so that if the next pathogen is detected, we know it right away and we know how to work. And we have the real opportunity to do that, but unless we work together across public, private, you name it, organizations, it's not going to happen.
And optimism in countering future similar pandemics?
I think we have never been in a better place. You know, what the trajectory of SARS-CoV-2 showed us is that we are in a different place, right? We identified the virus within a month. We had a vaccine that went through massive clinical trials for validation within 11 months. And yes, 6.5 million people have died attributed to COVID. 600 million cases confirmed COVID. Wouldn't say that's a success, but if we didn't have that vaccine within a year, the cases would be astronomical. So can we do even better? Yes, we can do better by once that's detected, you know, what can we do to be even more prepared for the development of the vaccines and the treatments moving on? Because now we know we're in a position where better than we've ever been to detect that signal early.